All right, so afternoon, everyone. My name is Ivo Siegmann. Welcome to the Northwest Seminar Series of Mathematical Biology and Data Science. This seminar series is co-organized by the Universities of Liverpool and Manchester and Liverpool John Moores University. And today, the seminar is hosted by Liverpool John Moores University, and our speaker will be Dr. Florian Pein from the University of Cambridge. Next week, we will have two talks on Monday by Professor Rebecca Shipley from University College London, and on Wednesday at 1 p.m. by Suk Kyung Kim from the Courant Institute in New York. And 2 weeks from now on Wednesday, but at an unusual time at 12 p.m., we will have Lynn Govert from the Leibniz Institute of Freshwater Ecology and Inland Fisheries in Berlin. So I would now like to introduce today's speaker. Florian Pein studied mathematics at the University of Göttingen, Germany, where he did his PhD in 2017 with Axel Munk. I met Florian in Göttingen when I was working there as a postdoc, and he was working towards his PhD. And I would like to share with you that apart from being a brilliant mathematical statistician, he also has a great talent for a sport that is taken very seriously at the Institute of Mathematical Stochastics. So Florian was the unrivaled champion of the tabletop football competition, which is played every afternoon at the University of Göttingen in the Institute for Mathematical Stochastics, and otherwise in every German pub, of course. But he was always kind enough to team up with more hopeless cases like me to give them a chance and him a bit of a challenge. So after finishing his PhD, Florian stayed in Göttingen for a bit, and then he came to Cambridge in 2018, where he is now working in Rajan Shah's group. One thing I would like to mention is that Florian is not only very good at developing new methods, but he is also very eager at implementing them and publishing them in R packages. So he maintains a few R packages, but he will tell you more about this in his talk. I look forward to his talk on model-free idealization of patch clamp recordings. Over to you, Florian.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction, and even more for inviting me, and to everyone else for joining the talk to learn more about patch clamp recordings. Before I will tell more about the patch clamp recordings, let me introduce my co-authors. This is, first of all, Axel Munk, my PhD supervisor from Göttingen. So most of this research was done while I was in Göttingen, but I continued with it a little bit while being now in Cambridge. Then there is Benjamin Elsner and Inder Dekula-Petler-Gomez, both were postdocs in Göttingen as well. Inder now has moved back to Mexico. And then there is Claudia Steinem and her former PhD students, Annika Bartsch and Ole Schütte from the Biochemistry Institute in Göttingen, who were measuring all those data I will present today. And we were very kind not only to share the data with us, but also their experience with patch clamp recordings and discussing the results. And several of our publications are with them together. Okay, I will talk about model idealization of patch clamp recordings. I will give you a short introduction into patch clamp recordings on the next slides. If you're not aware of them, for the moment, you can think of a recorded time series of conductance values. And the second terminology, model-free idealization, this is actually the part of the title, despite that I have chosen this title. It's a part I'm not really liking, since I think it's a very inaccurate title. As a statistician, I would prefer calling this a non-parametric regression or a non-parametric estimation. The term model-free refers to the fact that we are not assuming a parametric model for the gating dynamics. Instead, we have a very general non-parametric model, but I will talk more about this in the second part of my talk. But for historic reasons, I've still chosen the title Model Free Idealization, since in the community, those type of methodology are typically referred to as Model Free Idealizations. Okay, let me start by introducing you into patch clamp recordings. Or more specifically, ion channel recordings. Ion channels are transmembrane proteins that allow ions to pass into the cell, since they are needed for several vital processes in the cells, but they are not able to pass from the membrane themselves. However, ions can change their conformation over time and hence allow a different amount of ions to pass in a certain period of time. Hence, the conductance of an ion channel is changing over time. And a major research interest, for instance, for development of new drugs, is to study those gating dynamics. The major quantitative tool to do so is the so-called voltage patch clamp technique developed by Erwin Neher and Bernd Seckmann, for which they even received the Nobel Prize of Medicine and Biology in 1991. You can see below a picture of such a recording device. I mean, you don't see that much. What you can see is that everything is very small, since we typically, we try to record the conductance of a single ion channel. And hence, a huge amount of electronic is required to obtain those measurements. Very roughly described, what one is doing, one is inserting, is ideally a single ion channel into an official cell membrane. This is surrounded by a solution containing ions and an electrode to apply a constant voltage and to measure the current over time. Hence, our recordings are time series of current recordings, or when we divide by the constant voltage conductance recordings. On this slide, I'm showing you a first example how such a recording can look like. As mentioned before, it was measured in the Steinem lab in Göttingen in the context of our collaborative research center 803. More precisely, this is a gramicidine A recording. You see in the top panel 60 seconds. There are roughly two different levels at 45 picosiemens and maybe 28 picosiemens. There are three major changes, but also several shorter events, which are hard to see on this slide, but I will come back to them later. Now I would first of all like to model those recordings. First of all, the gating events itself are much faster than sampling. Hence the changes appear as abrupt random changes. And hence we measure the conductance of a channel by an unknown piecewise constant signal F. The number of change points K is unknown. The local conductance levels, mu j, are unknown, and also the change point locations, tau j, are unknown. So this model is very flexible, since we are allowing to have an arbitrary number of conductance changes and an arbitrary number of different conductance levels. However, we are obviously not able to just measure the signal f. We have additional measurement errors, which can be modeled by a Gaussian white noise process, either scaled by a constant. In this case, we have homogeneous noise, and we are able to pre-estimate the noise level as not by difference-based estimator. However, I will later talk also about heterogeneous noise, in which the scaling is given by a piecewise constant function sigma, which we'll then have to estimate as well. A major challenge is given by the fact that the conductance of an ion channel is very small. Hence, amplifiers are needed in electronic. And hence, also a low pass filtering is required to suppress some high frequent noise components, for instance, caused by short noise. So low-pass filters are essential and integrated in the hardware of a measurement device. However, from a statistical perspective, they are quite challenging since they are resulting in a time-continuous convolution of our piecewise constant signal with a low-pass filter kernel and with dependent errors resulting from the convolution of the low-pass filter kernel with the Gaussian white noise process. However, the good news is that the filter kernel is known since it's a physical part of the hardware device. And finally, the recordings obtained by equidistant digitization with a constant sampling rate FS. So as mentioned, the filter kernel is known. So on this slide, I can show you how the filter kernel looks like. In my talk today, I'm always using only measurements where we have a four-pole Bessel filter with a normal cutoff frequency. This means the cutoff frequency in time divided by the sampling rate of 0.1. I think in almost all patch clamp recordings, Bessel filters are used. I think either four-pole, six-pole, or eight-pole Bessel filters. And the cutoff frequency typically can be varied a little bit by the user who's conducting the measurements. So how is the kernel looking? First of all, the support is positive. This is necessary since we don't know future current values. We can only obtain a convolution of values in the past, since this is an electronic and not a digital filter. And secondly, we have one large peak. Then the kernel dips slightly below zero. And from there on, it's almost zero. In fact, the filter has an infinite support, but decays exponentially quickly. And hence, we make the approximation that we truncate the filter kernel, in this case, after 11 design points, or more generally, as soon as the autocorrelation is smaller than 10 to the power of minus 3. In fact, you see in the figure that there's not only, or you don't see it, that there's not only one line, but there are two lines. There's a red and a black line. The black line is the true Bessel filter, and the red line is the truncated and rescaled one. And since you don't really see a difference, this approximation works very well in practice, but will turn out to be very useful for our methodology. Okay, let's make it a bit easier, less technical, by showing you an example. So we start with a piecewise constant signal F. This is a black line. In this example, we have only three changes. Then we are obtaining a convolution with the low-pass filter kernel F. This is here given by the green line. It's identical to the signal at the beginning. Then, because of the convolution, the change is a little bit smooth until we reach back to the new function level and so on. And then finally, our measurements, or in this case, simulated observations, are obtained by equidistant sampling from the green line, so from the convolution, plus dependent errors, and the dependency structure is once again given by the low-pass filter kernel. More precisely, the autocorrelation is given by the convolution of the filter kernel with itself. Okay, on this slide, I have another summary of the model, but I don't plan to go in detail through it. I will just leave it to read it for you for a few seconds and pause here and give you a possibility to ask some questions in case you have some. Otherwise, I will continue talking about model-free idealization, or in other words, about obtaining a non-parametric estimation of the underlying signal F. Okay, it seems that everyone is happy. So let me continue by talking about model-free idealizations based on our previously defined model. Before doing so, I want to talk about three specific challenges that we will tackle. Those are flickering, subconductance states, and heterogeneous noise. So in general, we can have either the situation that all events are long, or we have some events that are shorter in time, and we can have that the conductance changes are rather large, or that at least some of the conductance changes are small. In the first situation, where conductance changes are large and all events are long, this is a quite easy scenario, and almost every model realization method will perform well. You could even use a simple thresholding approach, and it should work well, unless there are other challenges, for instance, baseline fluctuation or other artifacts, which could make an idealization more difficult. The first challenge will appear when some of the changes are smaller, so at least two conductance levels are close to each other. This is typically referred to as subconductance states, and our first idealization method will focus on this task, but also the later introduced methods will be able to deal with such recordings. The second challenge, and this is on which most of my research has focused, is about flickering, which means that some of the events are short in times. However, to make our life a little bit easier, we exclude the situation of high flickering, where two or more short events follow each other. So we only allow that we have one short event, then another long event, and then potentially again a short event. In the situation of high flickering, this combined with low-pass filtering, I think it's very challenging for model-free idealization methods, and I'm not aware of any model-free method that is able to deal with such a situation well, at least not when you at the same time aim for a fast idealization. The last situation, which I also describe as impossible, is the situation when you have short events and small conductance changes, then simply the events of a too low strength to be detectable. I think in this situation, no method is able to detect them reliable, even parametric approaches. Of course, short and small has to be always seen in relationship to the sampling rate, to the noise level, and also a bit in relation to the filter setup. The stronger the filter will be, the harder typical the idealization will be. And finally, I will talk later also about heterogeneous noise caused by open channel noise. Okay, before I will go to our three approaches, I first want to discuss on a higher level the principles. So as mentioned before, we're aiming for a model-free idealization, meaning that we make no parametric assumptions about the gating dynamics. So this is a key difference to, a hidden Markov based analysis. Secondly, we are aiming for a fully automatic idealization, meaning that no user interactions are required during the idealization. Only few tuning parameters has to be selected in advance, but we typically also our default parameters will work quite well. This is in contrast to some tools which are implemented in the standard recording devices, in which, for instance, the user have to select events manually, which is still quite common in the daily analysis, despite that it's highly subjective and also a huge amount of work for the people who have to do this analysis. Then we aim for fast computation. Ideally, the runtime should only increase linearly in the number of observations. This is essential since the number of observations is typically quite large. when you perform a recording for a minute, you're often having at least 300,000 observation points, maybe even few million. And typically it's quite challenging to start the first recording. This could be several months of work, but as soon as you have established your measurement protocol, you can often run measurements for several minutes, sometimes even for hours. So we have to deal with a large amount of data. Then our approach are all multi-scale approaches. I will talk about this on the next slide a bit more. But as mentioned before, we want to deal with a wide range of different temporal scales to detect subconducting states, but also flickering events. Our approaches comes with the following error control, that the probability to overestimate the number of conductance changes is bounded by a pre-specified parameter alpha. So this is one of the previously mentioned tuning parameters. So we have a certain guarantee that everything we idealize is in fact a true underlying effect or are caused by model violations such as baseline fluctuations. That's of course something we cannot exclude. And a key point of our approach in comparison to previous existing approaches is that we take the filtering explicitly into account, but our three approaches will differ in how they do so. And finally, at least two of our approaches allow for heterogeneous noise. Okay. Let me say a little bit more about multi-scale testing, which is also something that share all of the three approaches. Let's assume as for the moment that we have a candidate signal F tilde, and we want to know whether this describes the observations well. What we are doing then is we are testing on each segment on which the signal is constant, so everywhere locally and on all different temporal scales, whether this signal fits locally the observations well. In a simpler situation, meaning for instance, whether the mean of the observations is close enough to the function value of the signal on this segment. All those local tests are combined to a multi-scale test. And critical values are obtained by Monte Carlo simulations. This unfortunately might require a slightly higher computation time, but those Monte Carlo simulations have to be performed only once for each number of observations and each filter setup. They're automatically saved by our R package. And then as a finalization, we pick the candidate signal with the smallest number of changes that is accepted by the multi-scale test. So the multi-scale test ensures that we fit the signal well, and selecting of all those signals, the one with the smallest number of changes ensures that we are not including additional false positives. This might appear very hard to compute, but fortunately, we were able to compute it efficiently by dynamic programming, at least in a standard change point regression setting. For the Einstein recordings, the situations is a bit more challenging since we have to take low pass filtering into account, hence deconvolution techniques are required, and deconvolution techniques cannot be combined with dynamic programming without further ado. And hence, we have to, our upcoming methodologies have to do further steps around to do the regression computationally effectively. Okay, I will now describe still on a bit higher level, our three approaches. They are a bit technical, so I'm only able to give you the key ideas. If you're interested in specific details, feel free to ask me or have a look in our papers. So first of all, we want to deal with subconduction states, meaning that two conductance levels are close to each other. To this end, Thomas Hotz and co-authors have proposed JSMRF, jump segmentation multi-resolution filter. This was before I have joined the working group. And the basic idea is coming from the following observation. When we're considering the convolution of a piecewise constant signal with a low-pass filter, then the convolution differs from the true underlying signal only at the first m observation points after a conductance change. But afterwards, the convolution and hence the expectation of observation coincides with the underlying signal. So a very easy but still useful approach is on each signal on which you want to test. So for instance, from 3 milliseconds, so that's corresponding in this example to the change point locations, let's say to 5 milliseconds, roughly around here. But we then do to perform the test on this whole interval, we ignoring the first part corresponding to the first m observations and only testing the remaining observations for which the mean value corresponds to the true underlying signal. Obviously, this isn't helpful to detect shorter events. When the events is shorter than m observations, this approach is not able to detect such an event. And later, we were able to extend this approach to heterogeneous noise by combining it with heterogeneous multi-scale testing ideas. Basically meaning everywhere locally, you estimate the variance as well. And then more complicated statistical analysis are required to combine them to a multi-scale test. Since those test statistics aren't sub-Gaussian anymore, they are sub-exponential and hence follow from an extreme value perspective, they are in the Fourier domain of attraction. Okay, how are we able to deal with shorter events, so with flickering? So this I'm showing you, first of all, two examples. On the left-hand side, a simulated example, and on the right-hand side, real data. So on the left-hand side, the true underlying signal is the black line. The event is 3 observation points long. And the green line is once again the convolution of this signal with a low pass filter. But we see that neither the convolution nor any of the recorded observations, or in this case simulated observation, reaches down to the true underlying level of 20 picosiemens in this example. So because of this smoothing effect of the low pass filter, deconvolution techniques are required to estimate the conductance values. Okay, you might ask, why do we have to deal with such short events? Are they really important? Do they have any biological relevance? The answer is yes, at least in general. There are, of course, experiments where they aren't important, but in many examples, they flickering follows its own dynamics and results from different biological effects. And another example how short events can occur is because of blocking effects of larger molecules. And I will discuss later such an example. But first of all, let me introduce Joule's jump local deconvolution segmentation filter. This is now a three-step procedure. The first step is a multi-regression step, which ignores the filtering, but acts on all different temporal scales. So in other words, it obtains a piecewise constant approximation on the convolved signal. So it's not a regression of the underlying signal, but of the convolution. Then in the first step, we remove some incremental steps by a heuristic post-filter step. This works very well in practice, but it's hard to analyze. So our theoretical guarantees are only of approximate nature. But in simulations, we can show that it works well, and the same is hopefully true for real data. I will show you such an example later. But as soon as those two steps are performed, we have fixed the number of conductance changes and their rough locations, which then allows us to perform the deconvolution locally. Okay, why do we have to perform a deconvolution? As said before, we want to estimate the conductance level and also the precise conductance change points precisely. And this is only possible because of the smoothing effect by deconvolution. Okay, first of all, situation is a bit easier because of our assumptions of only having isolated peaks. We can estimate the conductance level on larger scales of large events. Once again, with a similar idea as before, we ignore the first M observations and simply take the mean or a more robust median to estimate the conductance levels of larger events. For shorter events, we are then remaining with isolated peaks. So we only have to estimate three parameters: two change point location and one conductance level. So this is now a local parameter estimation problem, which is hence much easier. We perform this by least squares minimization computed by an iterative grid search. So we simply search over all potential change point locations and then perform it with a finer grid around the previously estimated change point locations. Okay, let me come back to the example of a single peak from before. So the black line was the true signal, the green line was the convolution of this signal with the low pass filter. Now the red line is our idealization, and the blue line is the convolution of this idealization with the low pass Bessel filter. And the same in the example of real data, where of course we only have the idealization and its convolution. So we see that we are estimating the change point locations quite well. We misestimate the conductance level a bit. However, you can see that the blue and the green line are very close to each other. So the convolution of the two different signals are almost the same. So we see that it's a very hard statistical problem, since we have to distinguish those two cases and obviously other cases to estimate the conductance level. So some errors in estimating the precise conductance level is unfortunately unavoidable. However, also in the real data example, we see that the convolution fits very well the measurements, which is not only a strong confirmation for the accuracy of our method, but also shows that our underlying modeling is a good representation of the measurement. Okay, the last challenge I want to talk about is heterogeneous noise. In ion channel recordings, this is typically caused by open channel noise, a phenomenon causing larger noise when the conductance is larger. In this example, you see that the noise of a baseline is much smaller than the noise of the open state. The same is true when we zoom into this 1 second window. And hence, when we want to perform a multi-scale test, we are also required to estimate the variance locally, which is unfortunately impossible without taking the convolution into account. So what we have done previously, simply applying a piecewise constant approximation to the convolution, will not work in this case, since by such an approach, we are not able to estimate the variance well, and hence potentially overestimate the number of conductance changes massively. To overcome this issue, we have proposed HILDE, heterogeneous idealization by local testing and deconvolution. First of all, I want to talk a little bit more about our dependency structure, so about the noise. We assume an unknown non-stationary covariance. This sounds scary, but fortunately it decomposes into a non-stationary autocorrelation given by the low-pass filter, which we know, combined with an unknown non-stationary variance, which we model again by a piecewise constant signal with a strict restriction that changes are only allowed at the location at which the conductance is changing, since variant changes are also related to gating events. And then our approach consists of the following three steps. First of all, we use J. Smurf from before to obtain idealization on larger temporal scales. As said before, J. Smurf can be extended quite easily to heterogeneous noise. And then the key step is the following second one, since the previous step will have missed some short events if they occur. So we're performing additional local tests looking for shorter events. And those tests now take low-pass filtering explicitly into account to estimate the variance locally. To give you some more details, so let's consider the test on the interval from tau L to tau R. Then our previous idealization potentially includes a single change within this interval, denoted by tau. And we have previously the conductance value mu L, and afterwards conductance level mu R. So we are testing the previous idealization versus the alternative of adding another event, so another short peak. If this interval tau L to tau R isn't containing a change point at tau, so if it's just a constant line, we can include this by setting mu L equal to mu R and having tau arbitrarily. And if we have the rare situation that there are more than two changes already within this interval, this means we already have a short event, we aren't performing any additional testing, since we are anyway not able to perform the deconvolution for more than two change points, so for more than one isolated peak. And our alternative is of the following form. We have the previously estimated conductance level mu L up to tau L. Then we have a new unknown or arbitrarily chosen conductance level mu up to tau R, and from there on, the previously estimated level mu R. And we have the same structure also for the variance. So the key step to take the low-pass filtering into account is that from the previous estimation on large timescales, we have a certain parametric structure which we can use to estimate the standard deviation and to perform the test for an additional event. And then finally, the third step is that we're performing once again the same local deconvolution approach to estimate parameters. So obtaining a precise estimation of all change point locations and all conductance values. Okay, how is this working? I will show you an idealization by Joules for the Gramazzini recording, which I have already showed in the introduction. So we are finding the three major change points, and we are also finding some shorter events, which are roughly going down to the same level as the level of a larger event. And when I show you a third level zoom into those short events, we see, as seen in the example before, that once again, the convolution of idealization with a low pass filter fits the recordings very well. So those two facts combined, that it makes biological sense that those flickering events are of the same size as the large gating events. And the second fact that the convolution fits the recordings well tells us that our recordings or idealization should be of a high quality. And we also see in simulations that our idealizations are doing methods are doing very well. Talking about simulations, I have one last slide summarizing those results. As mentioned before, we have a four-pole low-pass Bessel filter with a normal cutoff frequency of 0.1. In this example, we considered a 10 kilohertz sampling rate. The signal-to-noise ratio is slightly above 14, corresponding to a conductance change of 20 picosiemens and a noise level of 1.4 picosiemens. So all those values resemble the situation that we had in the Gramazzini A recordings. So that's not arbitrary chosen values. And then to idealize those peaks well, we are trying two conditions. First of all, that the peaks are isolated. So the distance between them is not too short. In case of homogeneous noise, it has to be roughly 3.2 milliseconds long. For heterogeneous noise, roughly 6.2 milliseconds. This is because we have to also estimate the variance and not only the mean. But typically, at least for all recordings we have considered so far, those numbers are much smaller than the gating events on of the larger events. So this is not really a big restriction. But as soon as this is given, we can idealize much shorter peaks. For Hilde, when it assumes homogeneous noise, we can go down to events that are only 2.3 observation points long, corresponding to 0.23 milliseconds. When we allow heterogeneous noise, the event has to be slightly longer of 2.8 design points. And Joules, since it's not taking into account the filtering when testing, it's only taking the filtering into account when it's estimating parameter, it requires 3.2 design points. And J-Smurf, as mentioned before, it's not really designed for flickering. So we are acquiring 30 or 50 design points, depending on whether we have homogeneous noise or heterogeneous noise. Okay. If there are no questions, I will now continue discussing how we can use those idealizations to obtain quantitative statements about the gating dynamics. Since an idealization is somehow nice to have, but not the final aim of an analysis, I will do this by discussing an example at the context of multi-drug resistant bacteria. Here, the our collaborators aimed to characterize how the antibiotic ampicillin interacts with outer membrane protein 4B. So this is a protein in the outer membrane of bacterial cells. And some of its functions is to transport antibiotics into the cells. And we could study those characters by the voltage patch clamp techniques, since a docking event of an ampicillin blocks for a short period of time the ion flow, and hence resulted in a conductance drop recorded by the voltage patch clamp techniques. But as you can see, those events are very short in time, and hence our previously developed methods were essential. I think it's fair to say that none of the previously developed model realization method could have been used instead here. So we have one dominant level and shorter blocking events. And once again, our realization fits well to the observations. Okay, the first step then is usually to look at histograms. You can look at the raw data. In this case, you can only see the dominant level around 4 nanosiemens. But now with realization, we are also able to look at a histogram of the idealized conductance levels and at the amplitude, so at the difference between consecutive conductance levels. And then we are also seeing a second peak around maybe 2.8 nanosiemens, but also some other smaller events in between. This is better to see when we look at the amplitudes. We have a dominant peak around 1.2 nanosiemens and some shorter events. However, we have observed similar short events, smaller events also when we only started recordings of 4B without ampicillin. So those events are not connected to ampicillin docking events. So we're considering those events as artifacts. And then, and those are shown red lines, we can estimate the conductance levels of the ion channel by mode estimates. I think in this case, I have used the half sample mode. And secondly, one can map idealized events to the estimated conductance levels by the mode estimator. For instance, by saying I map all events around 4 nanosiemens to this level and all events between, let's say, 2.5 and 3 nanosiemens to the smaller conductance level, and I remove other effects since I consider them as artifacts. And as soon as this has been done, we have now a similar structure as one would observe when we would do an idealization using a HAM-M-based method. But we were also able by those idealizations to identify and remove artifacts as said before. The next step in analysis is typically to look at dwell times histograms. So we are looking at how long the short events are, and we are looking at the distance between two short peaks. In this case, the time of the short peaks corresponds to the residence time, so how long an ampicillin molecule is docked to the Pol-P channel. And we see that in both histograms, they are followed closely an exponential distribution. So we have, and we can also additionally test for independence. So we can use those model realizations to select, but also to verify a Markov model. But we see that some very short events are missed. In this case, roughly events below 40 microseconds. Hence, to estimate the parameters precisely, we have to apply a missed event analysis, which is available in the literature. And we were able to verify those results by an hidden Markov-based analysis, which, however, included taking filtering into account. So the computational time was very high. And we also had to remove a lot of artifacts for which we used the model-free idealizations. Okay, let me briefly discuss the obtained results. We have done such an analysis for different voltage levels and also for different concentration of ampicillin. And we have studied it for the wild type of ProB and for a single point mutation. And we have found that the residence time of mutation is a bit higher, and it shows a completely different dependence on the voltage on how many events we have. So we have a linear increase for the mutation and a slight decrease for the wild type. So in general, we can conclude that the single point mutation has a stronger drug binding affinity. And hence, together with some further analysis by other tools, we could, our collaborators could argue that in fact, mutation is less likely to transport an ampicillin molecule into the cells. So not only our coronavirus mutations are worrying, also mutations in the of the purines in the outer membranes of bacterial cells are worrying, since they could result to drug resistance bacteria. Okay, how much time do I have left?
Okay. You still have a few minutes, so it's 5 to 2.
Okay, I will try to conclude in 3 to 4 minutes. The last point I want to discuss is a comparison with hidden Markov-based analysis. First of all, I want to discuss the interplay between model-free idealizations and HMM-based methods. Let us first focus on the right-hand side, where I describe on a very high level how an HMM-based analysis can look like. The first step is to select and verify a hidden Markov model by model selection tools, but often also by cleaning the data to remove artifacts, since HMM-based methods are usually very sensitive to model violations. And then parameter estimates can be obtained by various different approaches, for instance, by the famous Baum-Welch algorithms, by Bayesian methods, in particular MCMC sampling, or by current distribution fitting. As soon as parameters are also estimated, one can obtain idealization by either the Viterbi algorithm or by Bayesian methods, for instance, by particle filtering. But when we have an idealization, we can once again go one step back and apply a missed event analysis to estimate the parameters. And we found that often those parameters, at least when flickering occurs, are much more accurate than the parameters we have immediately estimated by a Baum-Welch algorithm. However, model-free idealization methods are able to replace or assist many of those steps. We can use, as discussed before, those idealizations to select and verify a Markov model. We can use them to identify and remove artifacts. We can use the missed event analysis to estimate those parameters, which we then can use as starting values, for instance, for the Baum-Welch algorithm, which is an iterative procedure, which only converges to a local maximum. So a good starting value is essential. And finally, one should always use model-free idealization, or it's often a good suggestion to use model-free idealizations and the HMM-based analysis to verify each other's results on a level of parameter estimation, but also on the level of iterations. I have one slide about the advantages and disadvantages of HAM-M-based approaches in comparison to model-free approaches, but in the interest of time, I will go rather quickly through it. I think the biggest advantage of HAM-M approaches is that they allow for higher temporal resolution because of their strong parametric assumptions. Then they are typically obtained easier to handle results by immediately providing parameter estimates, a direct interpretation of the structure of an ion channel, and also allowing sampling from the model. And on the level of idealization, it immediately assigns a time point to each state. However, on the downside, I think there are two points very strong. First of all, the selection of the right Markov model might be difficult, in particular when the model is rather complicated, but this is a very essential step. You cannot obtain good results when your model assumptions of for the Markov model is wrong. However, this is typically somehow solvable since ion channels typically follow a Markov model. But for the second step, the hidden part of a Markov model might be more challenging since those methods are very sensitive to artifacts, since they act globally on the data, and since often data cleaning processes are required, which is potentially subjective, but also very challenging and often a large amount of work. And when flickering is important, taking filtering into account might be challenging and also computationally demanding. And also the approximation of a time discrete Markov chain might be an issue when flickering events are very short. And when I want to also mention the in Liverpool developed neural network approach, which in my viewpoint is somewhere in the middle. So it shares some advantages and disadvantages of both type of approaches. And I think it depends on training, how close it is to a Markov model and how close it will be to a model-free idealization approach. But I think my general recommendation is that those different approaches shouldn't be seen as competitors, but more as methods that complement each other very well. Okay, I will go very quickly to the conclusion. So I have provided a general non-parametric model in which low-pass filtering is a key part. I have discussed three different model-free idealization methods. I have discussed how they can use to analyze patch clam recordings, discussed an example at the background of multi-drug-resistant bacteria, and finally mentioned the interplay and comparison with hidden Markov-based approaches. This publication is a review paper in which you find further information on how to obtain good idealizations using our methodology. And as mentioned before by Ivo, I have also developed an R package for our method. So those methods are freely available. And together with student assistants, we have written a graphical user interface to also allow access from users with less program experience. With this said, I would like to thank you very much for your attention, and the floor is open for questions.
Thanks a lot, Florian, for your nice talk. Although it's already a bit past time, if there are questions, please don't hesitate to ask. So you can either unmute yourself or you can ask them in the chat. If there are no questions for now, I would like to ask one. So when you look at the different methods that you presented, I think you have presented three today. You basically presented all of them, but could you maybe say if one of them is better than the other, or should you look at a specific situation, which of them would be most appropriate?
Good question. We have given detailed guidance in the review paper on how to do so. But to answer it now, in general, from JSMOD to Jules to Hilde, the approach is getting more and more complicated. So first of all, maybe a bit harder to understand, but in particular also the computation time increases. So a general recommendation is to use the easiest approach that is somehow suitable, which means that if all events are long, we recommend to use JSMurf. If shorter events occur, we typically suggest to use either Jules or Hilde. In case of heterogeneous noise, one have to use the heterogeneous noise version of JSMurf or Hilde. There is no heterogeneous version of Jules. And typically, Jules is enough when homogeneous noise is present. But as I have showed you on the simulation slide, there is a tiny difference in how short an event can be to be idealized by Hilde or Jules. So for instance, in this multi-drug resistant example where some of the event times are very short, Hilde might be more beneficial than Jules.
So could you also say how they differ computationally? So is it maybe cheaper to use JSMurf, and for that reason, sometimes it might be just for time constraints, easier to use JSMurf first?
Yes, in JSMurf, we only have one multi-resolution regression step. For Jules, we have a similar step, plus an additionally more complicated local deconvolution step, which adds to the computation time. And for Hilde, there is an additional local testing step, which once again requires computation time, but also additional Monte Carlo simulations to pick additional critical values.
Okay, thanks a lot. There is someone in the audience, Veronika Bieger, who has raised her hand. Veronika, would you like to ask a question?
Yes, hello. I hope you can hear me okay.
Yes.
So I was thinking more about the your Hilde approach, where you talked about heterogeneous noise, which I found really interesting, particularly how it's modeled. And there I was wondering, so in this slide, for example, so you have a known autocorrelation and then an unknown variance. So related to the variance, I was wondering if it's possible to work out from the data whether when the level, which is conductance, I believe in your case, when the level is high, you said that the variance of the noise also goes high, I think.
Yes.
That's right. Yeah, so I was wondering whether one could look at a statistic like standard deviation over the mean or something like variance over the mean to work out whether there is a predictable relationship between the conductance and the expected variance of the noise. And following on from that, whether that would help make this a known relationship, I mean, the second component, whether this would become known and this would somehow help to fit the rest of the data.
Okay, what's the best way to answer this question? So first of all, when we obtain an idealization for the conductance, we could, with a similar, very similar approach, also obtain idealization for the variance. And typically, I think there will be no direct comparison. Let's say the conductance is two times higher, so the variance is two times larger.
Okay.
But I think, it's hard to say since you in this example, for instance, you have only two different conductance levels and two different variance levels.
Yes, I do understand that. So whether one would need to look kind of across multiple measurements to work out if something is such a relationship exists.
Yeah. This open channel noise is very hard to understand, and there's very little research on it. Can even when you have a new measurement, it's hard to say whether open channel noise will occur or not. For instance, we have several times of ProB recordings. When we are doing them at the using back lipid membranes, we don't see open channel noise. When we use the Porter patch, we have seen open channel noise, but it was with different quantities. So using somehow the same protein, the same membrane, and in some measurements, the open channel noise is much smaller than in other measurements.
I see, yeah.
Maybe one last thing I want to say. The J-Smurf step here, we are estimating the conductance while being robust to the variance changes. But when we are testing for shorter events, we in fact testing for changes that are simultaneously in the standard deviation and the variance, okay. Which is for typical changes which occur in ion channel recordings often more powerful.
Yes, no, I do understand. And thank you for that.
Yeah, thank you for your question. Well, definitely an interesting point. I'm a bit sorry that I cannot answer it better, but open channel noise is mostly seen as a noise artifact and not, there's one paper series on it, but other than that, I think there's almost no research on it.
Well, thanks a lot. Also, thanks a lot to you, Florian, for your nice talk. All the best.